been so long since you've been, and the life you had in Dublin now ain't nothing but a dream. To be right there in the moment, you'd give anything to be. That's alright.
National Geographic once called it the most beautiful place on earth. It suffered the Vikings, welcomed Hollywood, and its most famous local is a dolphin. This is the Dingle Peninsula.
If I have to break the bank, spend every penny on your dreams, it's alright, cause tonight we're gonna pick a town real. Just like
home. We begin at Dingle itself, a small fishing town pushed out towards the bay by a modest set of mountains. Dingle is arguably one of the island's more charming towns. Eclectic little fashion and jewellery shops on Green Street give way to intimate and cosy pubs such as Dick Mac's and Foxy John's. The latter is a DIY store with beer taps and consequently the only pub in the country where you can sink a pint and satisfy your hardware needs at the same sitting.
When we travel on the subway like it was the Lewis line, change the Hudson to the everywhere we kiss for the first time.
West of Dingle Town lies a staggering coastline, none other than the famous Stayhead Drive. It is on this famous road that Dunbeg Fort lies. On our journey west, we reached a small, peaceful village that is Ventry, and it is not hard to see why thousands of tourists come here every year. If you've gone this far, you will have to stop off in the mighty Paddy O'Shea's pub next, one of Ireland's most famous pubs. Once back on the road, you will soon see the signs for Dunbeg Fort and shortly arrive at the site. Dunbeg Fort's visitor centre provides an audiovisual and information on the fort. The Stonehouse restaurant next door serves delicious food to the tourists who come through here. Now, let me show you around. Follow me down to the site, a short 2-minute walk from the visitor centre. This is the pathway leading into the site. Built on top of a sheer cliff with a 95-foot drop on the other side, it is not a place to mess about. However, I feel this adds to the scene at the same time. A local man called Michael Moriarty firmly believed that these pathways were also used by ghosts and that they should never be blocked.
Here I'm standing in front of Dunbeg Fort. This is the entrance here behind me. It's an example of a watery fort situated on the edge of the cliff here, a sheer cliff. An example of a small, impressive fort. Its location makes it even more dramatic.
A souterrain, or escape tunnel, is hidden under these big stones at the front entrance and continues some 94 feet beyond the boundaries of the fort. This is quite an impressive feature for a fort that was built thousands and thousands of years ago.
Dunbeg Fort has many defensive features, and as shown behind me, there are the mounds of earth in four different levels here. These banks offer varied levels of protection. Here are the ruins of supposedly under defensive aspects of the fort, or else a burial chamber for perhaps one of the occupants of Dunbeg Fort.
Follow me and let's have a closer look at the inside of the fort. This dry stone rampart offered protection to the Clochan and meant that they could only be attacked from one side. Here we can see the stone detail and the lintel doorway into the Clochan. Again, there is a souterrain underneath this doorway to offer a quick escape. You can also see the dressed stone used to build the Clochan.
This dry stone rampart, or the external wall, was built to protect the inside of the fort. So probably the Clochan's here, as seen in the video. It's built in layers, as you can see, and it's assumed that the defenders were able to climb onto the different levels while protecting the fort. As you can see here, due to coastal erosion, a lot of the fort has fallen away, and this means that most of it has been closed off to the public, and that's been done with these guardrails here, which are running up over the fort. This is one of Ireland's biggest clochans, which is situated inside the fort. Originally there would have been a capstone or roof on top of this, but it has fallen away and deteriorated. many years ago an excavation work was carried out on the site, and it discovered many bones of animals such as deers, fish, goats, cows and sheep. So they believe that the cajon was maybe used for rituals perhaps, or as for people with high purpose or high rank within the fort. As you can see here, the stones have been dressed nicely on the inside, so it shows good craftsmanship for when it was built. The cajon is built the same as many other cajons in Ireland. It has the little doorway feature over, so that displays a large stone across the overhead of the doorway. And the specific doorway is a bit slightly different. It has two drawbar holes here, left and right, which we presume was used as another defensive feature.
This concludes our look at the inside of the fort. Here you can get a feel for the scale and the size of the fort. It really is a wonderful piece of craftsmanship for the time that it was built in. This concludes our visit to Dunbeg. Next, we will have a look at some historical sites on the Sleighhead Drive. The fort being built on the cliff face meant it offered ideal protection on three sides, but this also meant that the sea would eventually claim it. And a lot of it has fallen into the sea. Less than a kilometre west again are the Glanfáin Beehive Huts. They are situated in a small cluster on the southern slopes of Mount Eagle, also overlooking Dingle Bay. The entrance to these co-joined clachons is at the southeast of the central clachon. Also in the middle clachon, there is the entrance to an L-shaped souterrain, similar to what was seen at the site in Dunbeg Fort. These clachons also bear similarities to the fort in that they have lintel doorways. We continue on the Sleighhead Drive, stopping along the way to take in some of the beautiful scenery it has to offer. Next we arrive at Dunquin Pier, and then Commie Knoll. This pier and beach is famous for its surfing and strong riptides. It is a very dangerous beach, but also very beautiful. This beach is a very popular summer beach. Next up is the small village of Ballyferriter, and shortly after the village is this Riesk monastic site. The site is off the beaten track with a sign that's easy to miss, but perseverance is rewarded with an interesting and atmospheric site you can wander in peace. The site's most famous feature is the Ohm Stone in the middle. Galerus Archery is probably West Kerry's most famous religious site. Built using Corbel method of building, it has never been restored and is in perfect condition. Its front face resembles a beehive hut with its lintel doorway and shape, but it goes much deeper than any beehive hut. Kilmalkather Church is spread over a large site of around 10 acres. It is accessed through a gorgeous inclined Romanesque doorway. Blind arcading detail lies inside the church and a chancel arch too. Its most famous feature, however, is the Ohm Stone standing in the middle. The last site on our journey is Galerus Castle. Not as well known as the other sites we have looked at, but equally as beautiful. Conservation work has been carried out in recent years and the interior is fully accessible. Thank you for watching.